Hey, everybody. Hello there. Hey, everybody. Just realized I left my pens out here on the thing. Got them. Hey, everybody. Good evening. Good evening. My name's Adam Harris. Some of you might know me from Mountain Stage, and I'm so proud to be a part of the team that's working to bring you tonight's induction ceremony, both in the house here and for those of you watching live on our web stream, thanks to West Virginia Public Broadcasting. I'm going to do a couple of formal notes here. We're going to get the show started with our convocation. We have a couple quick performances before the show begins, and we'll get things started with our hosts in just a few minutes. We are recording and taping for this for television, and so if you don't mind, take a moment to silence your cell phones, iPhones, anything that might make a noise during the show. Even if you're sure, let's take a moment to reassure ourselves. Most of you have a program, and I hope you observe that program and acknowledge all of the sponsors who supported this evening's event, and I'm going to do so right now, so if you will, hold your applause, but we're going to acknowledge our sponsors, the West Virginia Lottery, the West Virginia Humanities Council, the Freshwater Family Foundation, the Glotfoundy Foundation, and AVN Corporation. We also have special thanks to Glenville State University, West Virginia University College of Creative Arts, School of Music, West Virginia and Regional History Center at WVU Libraries, Steinway & Sons, and I also want to say thank you again to our colleagues at West Virginia Public Broadcasting, our director, Chris Oxley, and his entire team, and also Chris Barnhart, our director of video production. Thank you guys for helping make this show so that not just here in the house you can enjoy it, but folks will be able to enjoy this on West Virginia Public Broadcasting. It'll also be a teaching resource for instructors all throughout the state as part of the education efforts at West Virginia Public Broadcasting. Thank you. And at this time, I want to welcome the man who helped to make this possible for sure. He's the president and he's the founder of the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame. Let's make him welcome Michael Lipton.
Hey there.
Let's put on the readers.
So, my name is Michael Lipton, and I'm the director of the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame. And I want to thank you all for coming out tonight to celebrate the music of our wacky and wonderful state. This is our ninth induction ceremony, and I continue to be both proud and amazed at the quirky and depth, and quality and depth of the artists who call West Virginia home. The message tonight for me is thanks. We haven't produced a live ceremony since 2018, and I guess I had forgotten just how many people and things there are to keep track of, and that we couldn't pull this off without the help of dozens of people. First off, I'd like to recognize and thank our board for their help and support. Would the board members in the audience want to stand for a moment? Bob Brunner is our chair, and Josh Barrett is our vice chair. In particular, I want to thank Sherry Hobbs for her patience and tireless help in pulling together the pieces of this very involved puzzle. One of the most important and lasting components of these ceremonies are the inductee vignettes. The multi-talented Michael Valentine has produced them since 2015 with help from Gavin Wisson. You can view all 62 of these on the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame website. And speaking of Gavin, he was a museum curator at his home in Rugby, England. He has beautifully designed and curated our two spaces in the Charleston Town Center. The Hall of Fame and the West Virginia Museum of Music are open Thursday through Sunday. If you're in the neighborhood, please stop by. Also want to give some special thanks to Richie Collins, who is both stage managing and running the monitor console. He also, give Richie a hand. He's in the hot seat, as we say. He also corralled our crew, most of whom you'll recognize if you've been to a mountain stage. And one of the many things I love about living in West Virginia is that I'm always working with friends. And we tell people this when we go to schools. It just doesn't get any better than that. Our relationship with West Virginia Public Broadcasting dates back to our inaugural ceremony in 2007. Once again, we're proud to have them as an important partner in this event. We'd like to thank their executive director, Butch Antolini, director of video production, Chris Barnhart, and Chris Oxley, who is directing the TV broadcast. The ceremony is being live streamed, and a two-hour edit will be aired statewide in a few weeks. This evening has shaped up to be a West Virginia-styled family affair. Please stand if you're kin to one of tonight's inductees. I know there are a bunch of you, and for some, I think it's their first trip to West Virginia. So, I know, I see you out there, stand up. It really makes things much more special when we have family here. So in putting together these events, we often are reminded that the world of music can be a small one, and West Virginia's world is even smaller. Barbara Nisman's choice for someone to present her award is Styx Hooper, the co-founder and drummer of the Jazz Crusaders. Coincidentally, Styx was good friends with Bill and Marcia Withers. When I was first talking to Fuzzy Haskins' son, Noel, who was born and raised in New Jersey, he said he'd been to West Virginia just twice. The first time was a funeral in McDowell County, where he was a bit shocked to see the family digging the grave on a hillside. His second trip to West Virginia, a number of years later, was to play Mountain Stage. How about that? Last but certainly not least, I want to express my gratitude to some of our past inductees for being here. Charlie McCoy and Tim O'Brien have been here for almost every ceremony. And believe me, it's not because they don't have anything else to do. Likewise, Larry Gross and Bob Thompson have also been ready to jump in whenever needed. John Ellison is in town, but due to a health issue, couldn't be here tonight. So please send some wishes out his way. For me, one of the most poignant statements about West Virginia comes from the late Bill Withers. And I say this every year because I believe it and I think it says a lot. The challenge is to get young people who grow up in places like West Virginia to take the limits off of themselves and realize that there's no magic that somebody else has in the world that they don't. They're just people. And man, that's a lot. So, thank you. And we do have an incredibly diverse show tonight that I hope you all really enjoy. Thanks.
Nice job, Michael. Thank you, guys, and thank you once again for being a part of this. It's my pleasure to mention that, as Michael mentioned, family is a big part of what we do here in West Virginia as far as our music goes, especially. And this next performance is certainly by one of my favorite family groups, led by a person who's very familiar to all of you. He's one of my favorite songwriters. I've seen him perform more than almost any West Virginia songwriter, I think. But beyond that, he's been serving the Hall of Fame on its board and in many other ways for many years, almost since the founding of the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame. And so I hope you'll join me in welcoming Georgia and Mason and their dad, John Lilly, Just Us Lillies.
You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. You be the hammer, I'll be the nail. If we get together, there's no way that we can fail. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. Look at all that work that lies before me. Wonder how I'll ever get it done. But I know I can if you will lend a helping hand. Two is so much more than one. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. You be the hammer, If we get together, there's no way that we can fail. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. You can help me harvest all my peaches. I can help you pick all of your beans. When it's supper time, you can have whatever's mine. Share what you got with me. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. Be the hammer, I'll be the nail. If we get together, there's no way that we can fail. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. We can put our differences behind us, step by step and mile after mile. We'll accomplish more than we ever did before, start and end each day with a smile. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. You be the hammer, I'll be the nail. If we get together, there's no way that we can fail. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail. You be the hammer, I'll be the nail. If we get together, there's no way that we can fail. You be the cross tie, I'll be the rail.
We just wanted to get that out of the way before the broadcast starts. Thank you. All right. How many folks have been to the Hall of Fame ceremony before? Okay. Very nice. Very nice. So what we do at the Hall of Fame ceremony is we begin the performance each evening with what we like to call the convocation. And our special guest here to perform our convocation is also one of our co-hosts this evening with an all-star band. Let's make welcome Lionel Cartwright.
Gone and rain. You see, I've had a long streak of bad luck, but I'm praying it's gone at last. The night was black, the roads were icy, those falling drifts were high, and I was weary from my traveling, so I stopped to rest for a while. I sit down at a truck stop. I was thinking about my past. I've had a long streak of that bad luck, but I'm praise gone at last. 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 I've had a long streak of that bad love, but I'm praying it's gone. Now I ain't dumb, I've kicked around some, I don't fall too easily. But that little girl, she looks so dejected, she just grabbed my sympathy. Sweet little soul, now what's your problem? Tell me why you're so downcast. I've had a long streak of that bad love, but I'm praying it's gone. Of that bad love, but I'm praying it's gone at last. Tim O'Brien now. Charlotte. In a while, from out of nowhere, you know you don't expect it, and you're unprepared. Someone will come, lift you higher, and your burdens will be shared. Yes, I do believe, if I hadn't met you, I might still be sinking fast. I've had a long streak of that bad luck, but I'm praying it's gone at last. Let's bring it down. Had a long streak of that bad love, but I'm praying, I'm praying, I'm praying that it's gone, 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 gone at last, gone at last. I've had a long streak of that bad love, but I'm praying it's gone at last. Back to Tim now. Michael Lipton.
our special guest, founding member of Leftover Salmon and a longtime friend of West Virginia music, Vince Herman.
Hello, hello, hello. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the 2023 induction ceremony for the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame. What an event, what an event. My name is, as he said, my name is Vince Herman. I'm glad to be joining you all here this evening, and I hope you're prepared for a night of exciting music, rich history, and of course, as always, a few surprises. Before we get started, I want to recognize several members of the Music Hall of Fame who are in attendance with us here this evening. From the class of 2020, songwriter extraordinaire, Mountain Stage founder and longtime host, Mr. Larry Gross. Right there. What a man. And from the class of 2015, jazz man, Mountain Stage pianist, composer, and band leader, Bob Thompson. Yeah. Yeah, Bob. We also have with us tonight steel guitar legend, Russ Hicks. Hey, Russ. From the class of 2013, Grammy winner, Wheeling, West Virginia's own, Tim O'Brien. There he is. Yes, sir. And finally, from the class of 2008, the legend, harmonica master, Charlie McCoy. Yeah. Now let's meet our hosts for this evening, these prestigious ceremonies. He has a career that has spanned decades and styles, an award-winning singer and songwriter, a composer for television, band leader, arranger, and a native of Mason County, West Virginia. And she is a renowned bassist, a Grammy nominee, a songwriter, highly regarded teacher, and a native of Mineral County, West Virginia. And the first woman to win the IBMA Bass Player of the Year award, and she brought home 10 times. Here are your hosts, Lionel Cartwright and Missy Raines. That's it.
Oh, I'm supposed to go first. Okay, I'm still learning this host thing. And by the end of the show, I'll have it down pat. Hey, it really is a treat to be here. I've enjoyed getting to know Missy. I've heard of you for years, never met you, but...
It's been my honor, actually. You're the one that was on the radio.
Oh, right. Yeah, we all watched it on the radio. Yeah. We want to welcome you to this year's West Virginia Music Hall of Fame induction ceremony. And we want to thank you guys for coming and everyone watching us. I sent the YouTube link to my folks, so my family's watching via YouTube, but you can also watch via the website. It's just going to be a very, very special night.
From bluegrass, which is close to my heart, to funk, to classical, to jazz, we are covering a lot of ground here tonight, just like our beautiful winding roads of this beautiful state. We'll hear a wide array of performances, from a Hungarian rhapsody and deep funk to ragtime fiddle, country tales of woe, and some driving Hammond B3. You guys are in for something tonight.
It's insane, and I just want to say, I met Count Funkula last night. Got my picture with him. I love it. I love it. Let's see. What am I supposed to tell you guys? Let's get started. First inductee coming up.
Formed in southern West Virginia in the late 1930s, the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers were one of the earliest practitioners of a high-energy style of banjo, mandolin, fiddle, and guitar-driven music that would become known as bluegrass. In various incarnations, the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers existed for nearly 30 years and provided a foundation and inspiration for many who would follow in their musical footsteps. Ezra Klein and his cousins, Ray and Ireland Klein, who hail from Gilbert Creek in Mingo County, along with guitarist Gordon Jennings, first performed as the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers in 1938 on the powerful Bluefield, West Virginia station WHIS. Ezra, the oldest of 15 children, became the family breadwinner when his father died. He took up bass after seeing a Clayton McMicken show at a local high school. A born salesman, Ezra kept the band active through many personnel changes into the 1960s. In 1949, a new lineup, inspired by Bill Monroe's up-tempo Grand Ole Opry performances, debuted, featuring singer and guitarist Bobby Osborne, Larry Richardson on five-string banjo, and fiddler Ray Morgan. Richardson, an early disciple of Earl Scruggs' revolutionary banjo playing, and Osborne, with his high-pitched lead vocals, brought that new sound to the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers. As the music grew in popularity, the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers became a vital training ground for bluegrass singers and players. Indeed, the later success of the Osborne Brothers, Jimmy Martin and his Sunny Mountain Boys, and 2013 West Virginia Hall of Fame inductees, the Goings Brothers, all benefited from their tenure with the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers. Curly Ray Klein, as he was known, left the coal mines and rejoined the group in 1952. Remaining for the duration of the band's run. He adapted his mountain-style fiddling to bluegrass and further refined it during his 26-year stint with Ralph Stanley.
Holy Orange Blossom Special, and here's Curly Ray Klein to do it.
Like his cousin Ezra, Curly Ray performed original novelty numbers on stage and sold countless keychains from his merchandise table. Curly's younger brother, Charlie, joined the band in the early 50s on five-string banjo and went on to be an important fiddler for Bill Monroe, also filling in on banjo, guitar, or bass as needed. Paul Williams honed both his singing and his songwriting with the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers before joining with Jimmy Martin's classic band and writing many of Martin's best-known songs. Banjoist Larry Richardson also went on to play with Monroe and made some fine recordings on his own, as did one-time member Udell McPeak. Other notable sidemen who passed through the band's ranks include Billy Edwards, Landon Messer, Lowell Varney, West Virginia mandolinist Charles Rex Parker, who later had a TV show with his wife Eleanor, and James Roberts, who later made gospel music history with his wife, Martha Carson. The Lonesome Pine Fiddlers made its first recordings in 1950 on Davis, West Virginia's Cozy Records, with the Osborne and Richardson penned Pain in My Heart, which was soon covered by Flat and Scruggs. In 1952, the band signed with RCA Records and recorded a total of 14 sides. With Williams on lead vocals, the group had jukebox hits with Dirty Dishes Blues and My Brown-Eyed Darling. The latter was written by Williams with Ezra's daughter, Patsy, and dedicated to her fiancé, Bobby Osborne, who was then serving in the Marines in Korea. During its years with RCA, the group relocated to Oak Hill, West Virginia, and then to Detroit as regulars on WJR and its popular Saturday night broadcast, The Big Barn Frolic. In November 1953, the band moved to Pikeville, Kentucky, with new member Melvin Goines joining his brother Ray and Ezra and Curly Ray. That incarnation cut sides for RCA, including its signature tune, Windy Mountain.
The sky. Then I would forget all my worries and my troubles. I'll just let the wind blow them by.
Through various personnel changes in the 50s and early 60s, the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers performed on TV in Huntington and Bristol, Virginia. Before leaving the group in 1965, Melvin and Ray Goines, along with Ezra and Curly Ray, recorded four albums for Starday, including one with fellow Starday artist Hilo Brown. Ezra ran a restaurant and a swimming pool in Pikeville, and the group performed up until 1968 when Ezra moved back to West Virginia.
One of the treats for me the past couple days is I've got to meet somebody that I've been a fan of for a long time, and we both came from the same town, Wheeling, West Virginia, and it kind of reminds me one time when I did Hee Haw, I met Grandpa Jones, who was kind of a fave of mine, and I said, "Hey, Grandpa, I play on the Wheeling Jamboree too, just like you did," and he said, "I think I beheaded you a little bit." So this guy beheaded me a little bit, but man, just one of my favorite bluegrass artists, one of my favorite absolute lead singer, lead vocal in bluegrass. But he's here to present the induction of the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers, West Virginia Hall of Fame member, Grammy winner, and Wheeling, West Virginia native, Tim O'Brien.
Thank you. Thank you, Lionel. And what an honor it is to be here again doing this very thing. I want to welcome the extended families of the Kleins, the Osbournes, the Williams, the Humphreys families, and the Goines family, all part of the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers family. To understand the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers, it helps to know about bluegrass's beginnings. And one thing about this music is it's family music. It's dressed up, polished up a bit, sped up. It sounded familiar but revolutionary to the rural listener, I think, when they got their records or listened to it on the radio. And the instrumentals played at breakneck speeds were some of the same tunes that they would have danced to at a square dance. And the ballads, the old ballads that some of the women of the family would have sung at home unaccompanied, were now accompanied by a fancy string band led by Bill Monroe. This kind of idea kind of caught on all through the South where people listened to the Grand Ole Opry. And add to this change in the music and becoming bluegrass, you added the electrical processing of a microphone and radio waves with amplifiers at either end, which bred a new technique and presentation. When you get closer to a microphone or farther away, you get closer, it's like you're turning up your volume knob on your Les Paul electric solid body guitar, and people get excited, and that's what the music bred, some excitement. Another thing that runs through U.S. history and through the music is the clashing and subsequent melding of cultures, and much American music is blessed with the combination of both European and African sounds. And in bluegrass, you see that mix in plain sight when you see the fiddle and the banjo next to each other on the stage, one invented in Italy and one in Africa. Nostalgia is another part of country music, and bluegrass was not immune to that either. Rural folks who lived in this had moved to the city in industrial times. They heard country music and they heard somebody they understood, somebody like them. It reminded them of home. And folks who lived in the country and tuned in on the radio, they heard somebody singing and they heard the ovations and they went, maybe I could do that. And I think that's maybe what Ezra Klein was thinking when he when he heard that stuff on the radio. Looking at it in retrospect, it's obvious that the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers provided a training ground for the Osborne Brothers, Jimmy Martin and his band, featuring Paul Williams, Larry Richardson, the Goins Brothers, and more. And these are the people that Buddy Griffin, who's going to be inducted tonight, and myself, as young bluegrass musicians, we emulated, we studied with them, we listened to their records, we listened to them on the radio, saw them on TV whenever we could. And the late, great fiddle player I used to know from Tennessee named Frazier Moss had a good quote. He said, "Bluegrass musicians will travel great distances to hear themselves play." And that's probably true, but Ezra Klein, the scrappy leader of the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers, was not going to accept that. He wasn't going to feed his family if nobody came to the show. So he used the radio star model as his business plan. You play at a, you get a job playing on music on a radio station several times each week, and then you play, you book personal appearances in the broadcast area, and if you start souring, you know, you wear that area out, you move to another station, and the Fiddlers did that, like so many other radio performers. And if he couldn't book a schoolhouse or a theater, he would hire a ball field and use a speaker on the top of his car to announce that the show was happening, and drive it around town and announce from his driver's seat. And he even towed a special trailer that converted into a stage. That scrappy way of business, doing business, survived in his cousin Curly Ray Klein, who, when he went with Ralph Stanley, he sold his Curly Ray Klein keychains. And I know I have at least a half dozen of those somewhere in my house I bought over the years. Folks talk about bluegrass being mountain music, but really, Bill Monroe was not a mountaineer, nor was Earl Scruggs, who were considered the founders of it. But Ralph and Carter Stanley were, and so were Ezra and Curly Klein and their family. They are really the epitome of mountain people, I think. When I met Curly Ray, I thought, this is the real thing. And when he played, it was the real thing. And he was a sweet man. Having Fiddler in the name really fits them, with Curly's fiddle always there, sawing away in the background of their recordings. And they are even named in after John Fox's popular novel, Trail of the Lonesome Pine, which describes the coming of the coal industry to the southern mountains. By the 1950s, country became more electrified, and the bluegrass, acoustic bluegrass sounds started to get squeezed out of the radio and country music. And the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers didn't quite ever cross the bridge into the college concerts and folk marketplace like in the 1960s, like Monroe and Flatten Scruggs and the Osborne Brothers did. And by the time that all started happening, the Fiddlers were winding down, and they just kept playing it to their rural fans in West Virginia and Kentucky. In today's world, where bluegrass artists like Billy Strings and Alison Krauss fill arenas, I just like to remember the music's humble beginnings in places like the Klein's home place. And it's with great honor that I welcome the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers to the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame. Please make them welcome. Here to accept, coming up to accept the award are Bobby Osborne and Paul Williams, former lead singers of the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers, and also Ezra Klein's grandson, Ricky Klein. Please make them welcome.
Thank everybody for coming out. My grandfather was the manager of the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers, Ezra Klein. He started the band and got it going with his two cousins. A lot was said before we came out. I'm his grandson, Ricky Klein. I got my family up here on stage, along with the Osbournes. So we got two intertwined families here, the Osbournes and the Kleins. So we are very intertwined here. So we got, this is a great day for us, a great night. Two family members inducted tonight. On behalf of Ezra Klein, a lot was said, so just a couple points that I want to point out. Ezra, he was an avid squirrel hunter and ran daily. He was in a lot of physical fitness. Ezra shot an albino squirrel and had it stuffed one time. We had it for years in the family and finally had to throw it away. So that was pretty cool. So we had to finally get rid of it. And I don't know, it was probably about 20 years ago. Ended up getting fleas and it had to go. Ezra was known for his smile, his kindness, his business smarts, his work ethics. People from all over the state of West Virginia would visit him and Margaret Klein, my grandmother. Ricky Skaggs even stayed at Ezra's home while he was in diapers for childcare. Ezra died peacefully in his sleep on July 11, 1984. Most of it was said before, but he was born January 13, 1907, and based in West Virginia, which a lot of you know in West Virginia is called Gilbert Creek. I'm not going to go through everything that was said because I heard it on the backstage, and it was much better than what I had written down. I just found out I had to do this about an hour ago. So, but what I like to do is point out who's mostly up here to accept this indoctrination. Please appreciate it. First of all, one more time, I know it was said before, but a lot of big performers that came from this band was Ezra Klein, Curly Ray Klein, Ray Goins, Charles Rex Parker, Melvin Goins, Paul Williams, Bob Osborne, Charlie Klein, Billy Edwards, Vidal McPeak, Larry Richardson, Ned Ireland Klein, Ray Morgan, Albert Pateri, and James Carson Roberts. Up here accepting this award and part of the family, we have Penny Klein, my mom, Ezra's daughter-in-law. Tina Osborne, which is Bob's daughter also, Ezra's granddaughter. Troy Klein, Ezra's grandson. Robbie Osborne, Ezra's grandson. Bree Honican, Ezra's great-granddaughter. Ricky Klein, myself. Deborah DeBar, which is not, he's not present, cannot make it, is Ezra's grandson. Jennifer Klein is Ezra's granddaughter-in-law. Wynn Osborne could not make it. It's Ezra's grandchild. Scotty Klein, which is my father, passed away. He would love to have been here, along with Pat Klein, which is Ezra's daughter also. Galen, Darren, Garen, and Shirley Osborne also. Scotty Klein and Pat Klein, they would be happy to be here tonight, and they are recently deceased. They would love to be here. We appreciate y'all coming out for this, and we greatly appreciate it. Thank you.
Stage left. Come on, that's right. Stage left.
So great. We're going to pay tribute to our first inductees with a performance, along with my co-host Missy Raines on bass, Ray Cawson on fiddle, Jan Fabricius, tripped over that, on mandolin, Jim Gabehart on banjo. Welcome back, Tim O'Brien.
How I'd like to be upon a windy mountain where the treetops scrape the sky. There I would forget all my worries and my trouble. I just let the wind blow them by. I'd love to hear the sound of the wind when it's howling. Singing, just a moment of relief is all I care. For I've got no sorrow, no heartache, or sadness, long as I can see the tree Jesus wears. How I'd like to be upon a windy mountain where the treetops scrape the sky. There I would forget all my worries and my trouble. I just let the wind blow them by.
Thank you very much. That's Ray Cawson on the fiddle there for you. We're going to do a song that was a jukebox hit. That last song was recorded by the latest, you know, the final version of the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers with Melvin and Ray Goins, with Ezra and Curly Ray. This next one is from middle period. I think of it as a middle period when Paul Williams was the lead singer. And this is one of their jukebox hits. It's called Dirty Dishes. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2.
I come in this morning at 8:15. You're nagging for being home late, but she didn't scold me or tell me it's wrong, for I didn't see her, my sweetheart was gone. Dirty dishes, dirty dishes, I'm losing my mind. My baby done left me and traveled behind, and now I'm so lonely. For me.
note on the table, and here's how it read. Now you've been cheating was all that it said. I started bawling, the tears were in vain to see my baby again. Cheated, I swear that it's true. Broken a promise that I made to you. You'll never know just how happy I'll be if you will come back and wash dishes for me. Dirty dishes, I'm losing my mind. My baby done left me in trouble behind.
Thank you very much, folks. Well, I'll tell you, I really am honored to do this, and I'm just nervous, you know. I don't know these songs so well, and I messed up a few words, and I really want to do justice to these fellas that did such a great job of bringing the music around. We're going to end with the first song that was recorded by the Lonesome Pine Fiddlers, and it was written by Bob Osborne, and he told me on the phone that this was the first time he was ever on stage. He got up in a talent show, and he sang this song that he had written, and he was just a teenager, and they had a big ovation, and he had to go back out there, and he didn't know what he was going to sing, and somebody said, "You got to sing something," and the only thing he knew was Ruby. Now, that's a guy who was destined for some greatness, wasn't he? He already had the good songs, and made a career out of both of them. Anyway, we'll end with this one called Pain in My Heart by Bobby Osborne. One, two, three.
When I first met you right from the start, you knew that I loved you with pain in my heart. So look in my eyes and tell me that it's true. Say that you love me, please don't make me blue. With pain in my heart and blues on my mind, I'll always love you, but can you be mine? Can you be mine with another man's name? You know that I love you. You love me, you will be mine. With pain in your heart and blues on your mind, please say that you love me and don't say goodbye. You know that I love you, for you I will die. With pain in my heart and blues on my mind, I'll always love you, but can you be mine? Can you be mine with another man's name? You know that I love you and I'm not to blame. Now when I first met you right from the start, you knew
I love you with the pain in my heart. So look in my eyes and tell me that it's true. You know that I love you, please don't make me blue. With pain in my heart and blues on my mind, I always love you, but can you be mine? Can you be mine with another man's name? You know that I love you.
Thank you all very much. Give a hand to all these fine pickers, including my wife, Jenny.
Hey, folks, before we move on, we've neglected to mention Melvin Goins's widow, Willow, and we didn't want her to get out of here without showing her some love. How about it?
Eugene Walls was born on October 17, 1942, in the back seat of a car in Ironton, Ohio, along with his twin brother, as his family was traveling back from Kentucky to their home in Charleston. An inauspicious beginning for one of the world's greatest Hammond B3 organ players. The third of eight children, Winston was raised in the Coal Branch Heights section of Charleston. At age 12, he was accidentally struck in the head by a brick thrown by a friend. Unconscious for nearly 24 hours, when he returned home from the hospital, he went directly to the piano, sat down, and started playing. It was indeed a Twilight Zone moment, as Winston had not played piano before and had not shown a particular interest in music. That story, often told by Winston and echoed by his brothers, is just one of the many tales that define Winston as a character of rare proportion. Winston's musical roots ran deep. His father, 2015 West Virginia Music Hall of Fame inductee Harry Van Piano Man Walls, was the house pianist for Atlantic Records from 1949 to 1954 and played on some of the most memorable R&B hits of the day. However, as his father lived in New York through much of Winston's childhood, it was Winston's mother, Margaret, who played drums at their church, who brought him his first drum set. She then started him studying with longtime Charleston drummer Frank Thompson, who also taught him fundamentals on piano. In 1960, renowned jazz organist Bill Doggett's trio was booked at Charleston's Municipal Auditorium. During their sound check, Doggett received word that his drummer was unable to make the gig. Winston, who had been hanging around backstage, overheard the conversation and told Doggett he was a drummer. After a quick audition, Doggett hired him on the spot. Winston played drums for Doggett for around 2 years. During that time, he became fascinated with the Hammond B3, which was still a relatively new instrument. Soaking up everything he could, Winston soon began playing organ for the jam sessions that often preceded Doggett's show. By 1962, Winston had left Doggett's band, moved to Pittsburgh, and formed his own trio. He and fellow Hammond player, brother Jack McDuff, had discovered a teenage guitarist named George Benson. Benson played with Winston for a time. Later, Winston and McDuff took to the road performing Battle of the Organ shows, and in larger cities, tag-teaming with Richard Groove Holmes and the incomparable Jimmy Smith. Winston's command of the complex instrument, covering lightning-fast bass lines with the organ's bass pedals, and his deep, soulful playing was rivaled perhaps only by Smith. Winston's admirers also included fellow organists Caesar Frazier and Jimmy McGriff, as well as saxophonist Lou Donaldson and Sonny Stitt. He also played road gigs with the Pointer Sisters, Charlie Pride, and Al Green. Winston's reputation as a stellar organist, a classic entertainer, and someone who could be as difficult as he could be charming created a certain mystique. True to form, for decades, he refused to sign a recording contract or cut a record. His reputation was, if you wanted to hear this phenomenal musician, you had to see him live. Winston led bands from the early 1960s until the early 2000s, playing scores of clubs in the Southern Chitlin Circuit, in the Rust Belt, and Midwest. He became quite well known in Indianapolis, Cleveland, Denver, Fort Myers, Lexington, and Louisville. In Charleston, his longtime trio featured his mentor, Frank Thompson, and saxophonist Marshall Petty. His shows attracted musicians of all stripes wanting to sit in. His time in Louisville yielded classic stories about a young Cassius Clay, who often frequented his gigs. At least once, he grabbed the microphone while Winston was playing and began singing Stand By Me. As the story goes, Winston picked up the mic stand and chased the boxer out of the club and down the street. While playing a club in Youngstown, Ohio, a disagreement with the club owner ended with Winston crouching under his Hammond and carrying the 400-pound organ out of the club on his back. He often laid his pistol in plain view on top of the Hammond to deter any trouble. Throughout his life, Winston also had stints as a professional wrestler, fighting as the Claw, a motorcycle trick rider, a professional roller derby skater, and a stand-up comic. But music was Winston's ace. In addition to organ, he played drums and guitar and was a soulful singer at home with the blues, gritty R&B, country, and smooth ballads.
Boy, I love you. Love you till the end of time.
In 1993, Winston finally agreed to record a live CD, tapping brother Jack McDuff to recreate their infamous Battle of the Organ shows. The album, Boss of the B3, was recorded live in Detroit and Ann Arbor and released on Ann Arbor's School Kids Records. It was co-produced by label owner Steve Bergman and West Virginia Music Hall of Fame director Michael Lipton. Winston's last public performance was on July 4th, 2004 in Charleston. He retired from the road and passed away at his home in Fort Myers, Florida on February 5th, 2008 at the age of 65.
Our next presenter is a member of the 2015 class of the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame. He's been a pianist here in West Virginia for almost his entire career. Please welcome band leader, pianist, and Hall of Famer, Bob Thompson.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. It's a great honor for me to be here to say a few words about the wonderful Winston Waltz. But before I do that, we're going to have some special greetings from legendary jazz saxophonist Lou Donaldson and from the great jazz guitarist George Benson.
Went out to the Lido to play a concert with Jimmy Smith. And when we got to playing, this guy comes, stands by the organ. In the first place, he was weird because it was kind of warm and he had on an overcoat and a top hat. So after the set was over, we took a break. And all of a sudden, we hit an organ. And Winston had got on the organ, playing Billy Boy. And the crowd went back over to the organ. And he played all top of the organ. Then he got down underneath the organ and played on the pedals. And everybody said, "My God, who is that?" See, it's Winston Wall. That's how I got his name. He was never famous because he never moved around. But he never came to a major city and did that. If he had, he'd have been a famous man. Because he could play the organ. Exactly what he said he was going to do, he did. And Jimmy knew it too. Yeah.
Hi, this is George Benson. I want to let you know that Winston Walls is my friend, a fabulous musician, a one-of-a-kind musician. I enjoyed the many times, oh, I should say not many, but the few times that we spent on the bandstand. And I was always amazed at the way he played and his approach to music being completely different than anybody else I had ever heard. And his personality was completely different also. I miss him, but I'm very happy about the fact that he's been inducted into the West Virginia Hall of Fame. Congratulations.
All right, you know, we always hear of people who are considered a legend in their own time, but Winston was exactly that. He was a legend in his own time. You know, I first heard Winston back in the 60s. He was playing the piano, playing the blues on the piano at a small club on the east end of Charleston called the Palm Gardens. And I remember going back a month or so later to try to catch him again, and he was gone. In fact, he was gone from town. And he was, it was several years later before he came back. And when he came back, he was playing the Hammond organ. And what an experience that was to hear him play the Hammond organ, like for the first time. It was different from the piano. It was as though in the organ he had found the instrument that gave him the means to fully express his wide range of feeling and emotion. And express is just what he did. With that organ, he could scream, laugh, cry, dance, swing, love, just about anything he wanted to do, he could do with that organ. I heard him play Misty one night for 30 minutes at a club called the Derby that was in downtown Charleston. And he literally had people in tears. And it didn't matter what the song was with Winston. He got a request one night for Red River Valley. So he did a swinging version of it, took it through several keys, and just wore it out. And when it came to him playing the blues, forget about it. You know, what a great player he was. If you knew Winston, you knew that he was also somewhat of a taskmaster when it came to musicians playing with him. He had no problem letting you know what you were doing and what you were not doing. And he was especially hard on drummers, since he had been a drummer himself. He sometimes played at these blistering tempos, and it made it a serious job for drummers to try to hang in there. when you played with Winston, he was going to take you to school. He was going to test your ability not only to hold the groove, but he was going to see how you handle yourself playing in every key. One of the things that he used to do was he'd start a blues at a really fast tempo, and after it got going good, he'd take it up a half step to the next key. And then at the end of each chorus, he'd take it up another half step. And he would keep on going until he had been through all 12 keys. And when he got back to the original key, it was like the sky opened up. You know, it was a beautiful thing. I love the times when there was another keyboard on the stand and we had the opportunity to play together. It was always big fun. There's one quick story I want to tell you. I had gotten a melodica. I don't know if you don't know what a melodica is. It's about this long. It's got a little keyboard, like a piano keyboard on the side, and a mouthpiece. You blow into it, and it sounds somewhere between an accordion and a harmonica. It's somewhere in that range. And I had customized mine. I put a trumpet-like mouthpiece on it so I could bend and shape the notes. And I used to pull it out on my gig every now and then. And so after a gig one night, I said, you know, let me put this, I put it back in the carton that it came in. So I'm gonna go around the corner in the Derby and play one with Winston, you know. So I went in and I was in the back of the club and I was taking it out of the carton. And Winston saw me and he said, hey, Bob. I said, yeah, Winston. He said, in the box. And I said, yeah, okay, all right, what is he talking about? Hey, Bob, in the box. And I'm still trying to figure out what he's saying. He said, put it back in the box. So, needless to say, I didn't sit in with Winston that night. He'd had no time for a melodica. I was also in the club one night and heard that there was a representative from one of the major record labels in the room that had come to town to talk to Winston about the possibility of a recording deal. And then I heard that Winston didn't want to talk to him. And he said, I don't want to talk to him. And I was like, hey, talk to me, man. You know. But, you know, I think about that a lot. And I just saw in the vignette where he finally did a live recording. Because I'm not sure that that the studio, recording studio environment would have been able to capture the essence of Winston Walls doing his thing. Winston loved that in-the-moment feedback from the people in the room. He was like a preacher delivering his message. He loved to grab a room full of people and take them with him on his journey. He loved to stir souls. And just like a preacher, every now and then he needed an amen to spur him on. In fact, you would hear him say to the audience many times during the night, somebody say yeah, somebody say yeah. And that was Winston Walls. So now it's my pleasure to make this presentation for Winston Walls' induction into the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame. And here to accept on behalf of Winston is saxophonist and Winston's good friend, Marshall Petty. Somebody say yeah.
Good evening. Once again, as Winston would say before the start of the meeting, somebody say yeah. Say it again, somebody say hell yeah. Okay, Bob pretty much covered a lot of things that I wanted to share with you about Winston. I spent about 10 years on the road with Doctor Who. He referred himself to often, I'm Doctor Who. And those 10 years was full of education, excitement, all sorts of experiences. So I want to share some of them with you. Winston didn't have a formal education with music. Most of his music came out of the streets of Charleston from people like, who was mentioned, Mr. Frank Thompson, Mr. Hubert Jones, better known as Rabbit. There was a gentleman named Reverend Phillips. So at any rate, that's what cultured Winston to where he was. Now, Winston, during our time on the road, we had a lot of laughs. And I just want to share some of those experiences with you on occasion that he would have let anybody come on stage and sit in. But you had to know him and prove yourself. So on one occasion, this gentleman came to the gig and he had his horn and he was tuning up in the back, and we all got on the stage, the drummer, the guitar player, myself, and this gentleman. Winston had heard him. So he went through the motions of introducing everybody, and he got this to this particular horn player, and Winston didn't approve of what he said, but when he mentioned, he said, "We have so-and-so on saxophone, but he will be performing tonight. He has a toothache." So that was one event. The other event was we were performing one night, and this saxophone player came in, and he set up, and he was enthusiastic about playing with Winston. Well, Winston had a favorite tune, "Rainy Night in Georgia." Well, when he began, the tenor player got by Winston, and he started playing over Winston. Winston kind of told him to lay out, and he did, and then Winston started again, and he started his horn again. Winston said, "Man, lay out." So the third time, he started it, and Winston was playing and started singing, and the horn player came in again, and Winston looked at him and said, "Man." And so I said, "Man, lay out." Winston told me to lay out. So after it was over, Winston motioned for him to come and listen with it. He whispered in this guy's ear, and then he proceeded next song. So I looked on the corner of my eye, and this guy was putting his horn in his case, and he put his hat on, and he ducked out the side of the stage. And after the next song, I said, "Winston, what did you say for him to leave?" He said, "I told him, after tonight, don't come back." Okay. Well, anyway, there was one other incident that why Winston was such a, I don't know where he got his talent from, but he was a very formidable organ player. And one night we were sitting in with some very professional musicians, and he called the song "Canadian Sunset." And it was at a moderate tempo, but about halfway through the song took on a different composition, different composure. And I listened, the song was there, but something wasn't quite right. So after the song was over, everybody stopped playing. Winston was still playing the same song, but in another key. And the whole time the song was going, he was playing the same song in one key with his right hand, and the same song on his left hand in another key. And I had never since then or even heard, and I Googled it. It is possible, but I didn't think I would ever meet anybody that would do that. One last thing before I close, as I may, is that this is really comical. Winston loved automobiles. He had Cadillacs, he had, you name it, Lincolns, he had them all. Well, he came to the gig one night and he had this beautiful Eldorado Cadillac, white on white and white. And he parked it on the sidewalk, and I went out and looked at it. I said, "Man, where'd you get that ride?" So he said, "I got it from a used car shop down the street. He told me I could take it for a ride, so I'm going to take it back after the gig." So he parked it on the sidewalk in a no parking zone. So a gentleman came in and said, "Whoever owns that white Cadillac, it has to be moved." I said, "Well, that's Winston." So I walked over and I said, "Winston, they want you to move your car." I said, "Give me the keys now. I'll move it." He said, okay, man. So he got up from his organ and went in the organ bench and pulled out a screwdriver. I just shook my head. That is my experience with the late, great Winston Eugene Walls. And on behalf of his wife, Lucille Walls, who was unable to attend, she wanted me to express her gratitude. And on behalf of Lucille Walls and the Walls family and myself as well, we'd like to thank the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame for this prestigious award for Winston Walls. Thank you so much.
Oh, right here. Here.
Here to honor Winston Walls, please welcome Noel Scott on drums, Michael Lipton on electric guitar, Rob Dixon on tenor sax, and on Hammond B3, Caesar Frazier.
Well, I'm gonna thank you, pretty baby, giving your love to me. I wanna thank you, pretty baby, giving your love to me. My heart was locked up till you came and set it free. Hey, I'm gonna love you in the morning, love you in the evening too. Oh, I'm gonna love you, pretty baby, love you till the evening too. I wanna thank your folks, making you so divine. Say thank you for your loving way. Oh, I wanna thank you for your loving way. I wanna thank you, 'cause you've been so kind. See, I'm gonna love you in the morning, kiss you in the evening too. Yeah, I'm gonna love you in the morning, kiss you in the evening too. I wanna spend the rest of my life loving nobody but you. Hey, all right, Michael.
Right, you got it.
till the end of time. Hey, baby, I'm gonna love you, 'cause you're mine, oh, mine, oh, mine. Say, I wanna thank your folks for making you so divine. There's one more thing. I'm gonna kiss you in the morning. See, I wanna kiss you in the evening too. Yeah, I'm gonna kiss you in the morning, baby. Kiss you in the evening too. I'm gonna thank your folks making you so divine.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, folks. That was a tribute to the one and only Weston Walls, all of those songs he liked to do. Before I go, I'm going to tell you a story. And actually, John Bales, who has been after me since last year to come up here, he wanted to know, and he chose me to come up here because I had obviously known Winston. And he wanted me to not finish until I tell this little story, and I make it short. Winston was a gunslinger. And when I say that, he was the only organ player that I knew, and I knew probably 500, including the great Jimmy Smith and Mac Duff, and we were all friends. But he was the only person that went around putting notches on his gun. He took pride in challenging every organ player he heard of. So one night in about 1971 or 72, I had already heard of Winston because of articles in Downbeat magazine, which is kind of the Bible of magazines for jazz. And they would talk about how this Winston Wall guy would follow Jimmy Smith around from one place to the next and walk in the door saying, I'm not going to say exactly what Winston said, you know, because it's X-rated, but he would say, you know, how Jimmy couldn't play and this and that and the other. And he would always challenge Jimmy. So everybody challenged Jimmy McGriff. He challenged Groove Holmes, all of the practitioners back then. So one night I walked in a place in Indianapolis, and he had heard of me, and he had heard that I was there. The guy whose band it was, Bobby Watley, who had played drums at Winston, announced that I was in the house, and as soon as Winston heard that, it was like a black mamba. He wanted to see, he had heard of me, and he wanted to challenge me. So he waved for me to come up to the stage, to the organ, and we battled. We battled for about 20 minutes, and when we, and I was young and fearless and energetic, and when we finished, he said, man, you a bad MF. He said, man, they talk about Jimmy Smith, but man, you probably sound more like Jimmy than any of them. So he wanted to go to breakfast with me, and he loved the Waffle House. So he wanted to go to breakfast, and he and I sit up there just talking shop until about 5 or 6 in the morning. He's telling me all of his antics, you know, about what to do, you know, in case somebody come in to challenge you. But anyway, Winston, I talked with Winston right up to the time his life was ending. He was in Fort Myers, Florida, and I happen to live in Central Florida, but we talked on the phone. And the funny thing about Winston, as fierce a competitor as he was, as the days were kind of drawing near, he would always tell you he loved you. I said, I love you too, Winston. And then the next thing you know, his light was out. So I feel an honor that I was asked to come up here and do this for Winston. And I've been trying my best to advertise Winston because he wasn't extremely widely known. And I've had people write me from Sweden and Italy saying, well, is he recording anymore? And I had to remind them that, or tell them they didn't know that Winston had passed away in 2008. But anyway, it strokes my heart to give honor to Winston because Winston was truly one of a kind. I mean, as far as his natural gifts, I mean, he would take a guitar and he'd play the blues like Chuck Berry. I mean, the guy was just different. Anyway, thank you so much for having me tonight.
Buddy Griffin is perhaps the most revered bluegrass and traditional country musician active in West Virginia today. Equally accomplished on banjo, fiddle, guitar, mandolin, bass, and auto harp, Griffin has performed on the Grand Ole Opry more than 200 times, appeared on more than 150 record albums, and toured for more than 30 years with some of the biggest names in the business. Born in Richwood, Nicholas County in 1948 into a musical household, Buddy Mason Griffin was the sixth of eight children. Parents Richard and Irma kept their home well supplied with musical instruments, and playing music was a daily feature of their home life. Richard's father, Joe Griffin, was an old-time clawhammer banjo player who often played for square dances at the logging camps in Roane, Lincoln, and Calhoun counties. Richard played the fiddle and guitar and sang lead, while Irma harmonized and played guitar and bass. Buddy was quick to pick up all the instruments, and their family band, known as the Sunny Valley Boys, performed locally at schoolhouses, pie socials, and square dances. In 1966, the Griffin family moved to Sutton, Braxton County, where the Sunny Valley Boys appeared weekly on radio and TV shows. In 1973, Griffin was hired as a staff musician at WWVA's Jamboree USA in Wheeling, where he played banjo and fiddle behind many of the featured guests, including Mother Maybelle Carter, Mack Wiseman, Johnny Russell, John Hartford, and Keith Whitley. Griffin left WWVA to work in Cincinnati clubs. While there, he joined 2013 West Virginia Music Hall of Fame inductees, the Goins Brothers, as the group's fiddler. He also began a long tenure with Katie Lauer, one of the first women to front a bluegrass band, both touring and recording.
On fiddle and guitar and nonsense from Summersville, West Virginia, Mr. Buddy Griffin.
In 1982, Buddy made his first of many appearances on the Grand Ole Opry as the fiddler with country music singer Johnny Russell. In the 1990s, Russell convinced Griffin to move to northern Arkansas, where he joined the cast of the Ozark Mountain Hoedown by Night and worked with various groups, notably Christy Lane and Al Brumley, in Branson, Missouri by day. He later became the fiddler for bluegrass stars Jim and Jesse McReynolds, with whom he appeared weekly on the Grand Ole Opry radio and TV shows for a decade. By 1997, Griffin felt the time had come to return to West Virginia to help his parents. He had received an education degree from Glenville State College in 1971 and taught English in Nicholas County. He had long envisioned an academic program where students could earn a college degree in the study and performance of bluegrass music. In 2002, his dream was realized when Glenville State College became the first school in the world to offer a four-year degree in bluegrass music. Griffin was founder and director of the program for several years. In 2011, Griffin retired from Glenville State College and received the 2011 Vandalia Award from the West Virginia Division of Culture and History, as well as an honorary doctorate from his alma mater. Griffin then moved to Nashville, where he continued working with Jesse McReynolds and playing on the road with Bobby Osborne and the Rocky Top Express. In 2014, he was part of Osborne's Celebration Tour, 50th anniversary on the Grand Ole Opry. Although Griffin never released singles under his own name, he has released cassettes and CDs as the Buddy Griffin Band, in which he played all the instruments, and a number of collaborations with his friend Ashley Messenger. Griffin is well known and respected as a sideman who contributed to the success of many legendary artists. He currently makes his home in Jane Lou.
What a crazy night. What a great night. So I guess you saw Buddy Griffin also played on the Wheeling Jamboree. Turns out he beheaded me too. But to present the induction of Buddy Griffin is educator, author, square dance caller, and the man who hired Buddy Griffin to play bass with the Sample Brothers in 1979. Would y'all make welcome Max Samples.
Good evening, one and all, or as Buddy's all-time hero, Lester Flatt, would say,
Howdy, friends and neighbors. That's what Lester always said. But I want to speak a little bit about the West Virginia Buddy Griffin that I knew and still know. You heard all these wonderful things that he's done on the national scene and made himself a tremendous reputation, especially among bluegrass musicians. He also played with country bands like Johnny Russell. So he had a very wide and exciting experience in bluegrass and country music. But let me back up a minute and tell you about Buddy in West Virginia. The first time I ever saw Buddy Griffin, I was a student at Glenville State College, and I saw in the Glenville paper that the Griffin family was going to be playing out at a park, a little town called Sand Fork. I didn't know who the Griffin family was or anything, but being a musician, I thought, I'll go out and hear that. So I got out there, and 16-year-old Buddy Griffin played with his mom and dad, playing bluegrass banjo, nailing those Earl Scruggs licks like he'd been doing it all his life. I was very impressed. I didn't talk to him, I don't think at all. And after that, I didn't see him for 9 years or hear him because he was going on his track and I was going on mine. Just didn't cross paths. Then in 1973, I think it was, a friend of mine named Frank Bell and I drove over to Huntersville, North Carolina because we heard there's a festival there. We walked onto the grounds and a group called the Black Mountain Boys were getting ready to play. And we were way back in the back, probably 50 yards from the station, standing there talking. And all of a sudden, the fiddle kicked off, and Frank looked at me, and he said, who is playing that fiddle? And I said, I don't know. So we walked up, and I hadn't seen him for 9 years. Wasn't sure it was him. I said, it looks like Buddy Griffin, because when I saw him, he was playing the banjo. But in between the time I saw him and then, he had mastered the fiddle. And that is where, I guess, he more than any other way made his mark in the music on the national scene. But I didn't see him again for a long time, for same reason, we were on different tracks. But then my band played at the Stonewall Jackson Jubilee for 30 years. And one day he showed up over there with his mom and dad to play. And he came outside where we were playing and started playing with us. And he said, I'd like to play with you guys. So we said, we'd be glad to have you. So then that's when we really got acquainted. And since that time, Buddy Griffin has played countless gigs with the Samples Brothers band, all the way from Mariposa, Kennedy, down to Memphis, Tennessee, and various other places. And the great thing about him was he did not mind a bit driving 8 or 9 hours to get to play with us after he was played somewhere else with somebody else. There was one place where he couldn't get home, and that was when the stand he did in Branson, so I didn't see much of him then. But he's played when he could with my band, and he also has been the mastermind behind the first cassette tape my band did and three CDs. Not only did he play on the CDs, but he also engineered and mastered it and put it in the form that it takes to become a CD. And another thing about Buddy that hasn't been mentioned, Buddy is our great harmony singer. And we soon discovered that in our band. And he added a dimension to my band that had never been there before and has always been with us since Buddy came along. One guy in Glenville said he ruined the Samples Brothers band because we didn't do the stuff we did before he came along much. But anyway, one more thing I want to say about Buddy that hasn't been said. He's a kind of a musician that I don't care which band he's playing in, everybody plays better. He's that kind of a musician. And I say that without any reservations because I've seen him do it a lot of different times. So I think one of the things the point I wanted to make is even though he was making a national reputation for himself, he did not forget his roots. He came home often, played gigs with his mom and dad, played with us all the time. And more than anything else, he's just a fun guy to have in the band. And Buddy and I have had a long and great relationship. Now that we're both retired, we only live 4 miles apart. And he graces my supper table many evenings. Many evenings. And the Samples have almost adopted him as one of their own. So, if you'll let me borrow a line from the politicians, it's a distinct personal honor for me to introduce to you Buddy Mason Griffin.
Look at this.
Say something, Bud.
You know, after Mac and everybody else, I don't know if there's anything I can remember. But I truthfully, this time I did write down some notes. But it's been tossed around here all night about families and music in families. And mine was, that's all we did. We played music. Mom and Dad were some of the greatest I ever knew. In fact, they should be standing here right now. And all the brothers and sisters, one brother in particular, my brother John, he played rock and roll, and he loved it. We tried to get him indoctrinated into bluegrass, but yeah, he didn't fall for that. Ruth and Louise, the older sisters, they had a gospel singing trio with another girl who lived close by, and they went to churches and did that kind of thing. Lucille, a great singer, and she played guitar, but we never could get her out to do anything. She just wouldn't do it. But bless her heart. So she's probably one of the most talented ones of us. My other two sisters, Janet and Pam, are actually here tonight. I don't know where you are, but yeah. Both solid musicians. Janet is, we always call her a trained musician. She has a degree in music from Glenville State College. And Pam, who incidentally surprised me, she came all the way from Dallas, Texas tonight. And well, not surprised, she lied to me. You know, I talked to her a couple of days ago and she said, plane reservations are just not, they're just not working out. So I'll get you later for that, Pam. But I did want to mention a few other people. My friend George Daugherty, and this is funny, my mom thought I was going to be a lawyer because I hung around with George Daugherty, the Earl of Bellevue, and he was a lawyer, so Mom, I'm sorry. There are many other people that I grew up with playing music. George Ward, went to high school with him. We've played for years and years and years. Johnny Talbert, another one from Hinton. And he was there when we did TV show the first time. And I still get with those guys and play occasionally. And of course, Mac and his band. But Thelma feeds me, and that really makes the difference. And I couldn't do this without mentioning Glenville State College, because Professor John McKinney and his wife Cheryl, Harry Rich, everybody who was there when I started there, they gave me a chance to do something I'd wanted to do all my life, and that was to teach and teach what I loved. And so we did that. They also taught me how to be a faculty member, and that's, you know, that was important too. But above all, everybody I've mentioned here at this point has been a great mentor, and I consider them standing right up here, right now, with me. So thank you all very much, and thank Michael and the board and the Hall of Fame. I really appreciate this honor.
So great. Well, it is now our honor to feature our latest inductee with her performance, along with Missy Raines, Tim O'Brien, Charlie McCoy. Here is Max Samples, and on fiddle, Buddy Griffin.
To come out, you did anyway. Thank you very much. Let's welcome Charlie McCoy, Tim O'Brien, and Missy Raines. The reason I wanted Mr. McCoy to come out and play with this is because there was a version of this tune done by Earl Scruggs back in the mid-60s, and I heard it and I thought, wait, that's a harmonica. And sure enough, it was. I was right. But it was this young man right over here playing that. So we're going to try to squeeze through this age-old tune, but it never loses its flavor with me. Well, maybe not.
Maybe not.
Now we got him. Are you ready?
Thank you.
How are y'all doing? Me too. I just wish there were two of me right now. The Spirit Award is presented to a group or an individual that embodies the giving spirit, the tenacious determination, the passion for promoting and sharing music with those who need to hear it most. I love that. Here to recognize this year's Spirit of West Virginia Music honoree is a true legend in country music, a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame, and a 2003 inductee into the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame, Fayette County born Charlie McCoy.
Thank you, Missy. Hey, it's my pleasure tonight to introduce the gentleman for the Spirit Award, because this is a guy that I knew well, and I worked with him in studios in Nashville on several occasions, and he was just one of a great, great guy, and you're gonna be amazed at his accomplishments. Jim Fogelsong was born in Lundale in Kanawha County, 1922, grew up in a musical family in Charleston. By age four, he was singing in church, and in high school, he was performing with various vocal groups on the radio. After graduating with a degree in voice and music theory from Eastman School of Music, Eastman, y'all, that's heavyweight stuff, he moved to New York City, where he began singing career with Arturo Toscanini's New York Philharmonic Orchestra and Fred Waring's Pennsylvanians. In 1951, he signed on with Columbia Records, helping launch their Epic subsidiary. 1964, he was hired by RCA Victor to produce pop acts including Robert Goulet, Doris Day, Julie Andrews, Les Paul and Mary Ford, and Al Hurt. Fogelsong moved to Nashville in 1970 to head up Dot Records, and became president in 1973 on the strength of the success he had with country artists such as Roy Clark, Donna Fargo, and Hank Thompson. That's when I worked with Jim, with Roy Clark, and with Donna Fargo. His career-defining work with Capitol and the MCA and labels were where he helped chart the course that would bring country music to a wider audience. Among the artists he signed were Garth Brooks, the Newgrass Revival, Reba McEntire, George Strait, Susie Boggess, and Tanya Tucker. Whoa. In Nashville, the records Fogelsong promoted won 46 Grammy, CMA, and ACM awards. He was inducted in the Country Music Hall of Fame in 2004. On a personal level, an unusually generous with his time, and mentored many musicians and men throughout the music business. After retiring from the industry, he became the head of the music business department at Tribeca Nazarene University in Nashville, and also taught a music business class at Vanderbilt University. A longtime member of Nashville's Vine Street Christian Church Chancel Choir. He sang every Sunday until 2 months before his death, 2 weeks shy of his 91st birthday. And one time he and I were just in a general conversation and talk about the small world. He said, "You don't know this, but my father was a pastor of a church in your hometown, Oak Hill." So it is my pleasure to present the Spirit Award to Jim Fogelsong. And we're going to have a couple of special greetings from Sam Bush, Susie Boggess, and West Virginia Music Hall of Famer Kathy Mateo.
Hi, folks. My name's Sam Bush, and I'm here acknowledging the contributions of West Virginian Jim Fogelsong. Jim was a record company executive in Nashville from 1951 through 2012. Not only that, the president of labels such as Dot, ABC, Capitol, and MCA Records. One night, Jim's wife, Toni, who they were singers together with the Fred Waring Orchestra when they were young, came to hear us and went home and told her husband, who was then the president of Capitol Records, Jim, that she just heard a band called Newgrass Revival that doesn't sound like anybody else. So wasn't too long, Jim heard us and personally signed us to Capitol, telling us, you guys make the music, I'll sell it. And that's the way he was. He was looking for the new thing, not just what he had done before. So thank you very much to Jim Fogelsong for your vision and guidance. We appreciate you.
Hi, I just wanted to chime in too and say I'm so happy that Jim Fogelsong is being inducted into the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame. It's so well deserved. He was such a great mentor to me and so many other artists, even people that were not the artists, but people on different labels, people who were songwriters and A&R people, producers. Everyone really loved Jim's input because he was so chill and sage about things, you know? He knew stuff. And he was just so great to be around because he was so positive and just made you feel comfortable. Like, not everything he did was going to, like, send you into the black hole of music business. So it was great to work with him. It was an honor to work with him, honestly. And when I first got offered my record deal, he and Terry Choate had come over to see me perform at Dollywood, the very first season that Dolly had bought the park. So I got to have a meeting with her afterwards, and she told me that she couldn't think of anybody better for me to be working with, that Jim was a great gentleman and also a great teacher, and I was really green, and she was right. He ended up being just what I needed to start things out for me, and it was a wonderful, wonderful experience, and wonderful singer and musician as well. So he's going to the right place here, and I'm just so happy he's going to be remembered this way.
Hi, this is Kathy Matea, and I'm glad to be part of this year's ceremony, even if it's through a virtual video. It's a thrill for me to see Jim Fogelsong be honored with this Spirit Award. I got to know Jim a little bit, even though I was not part of his record label. He did a kindness for me when I was just a young singer in Nashville, and his kindness was based on us both being from West Virginia and from the Charleston area, and I never forgot it. We stayed in touch over the years, and I got to speak at a tribute to him when he was still alive, and the music business was honoring him and saying thank you for all the years of service. So he really embodied the spirit of West Virginia hospitality and how that used to be kind of the heart of the way Music Row operated. And it was a thrill when I finally got to meet him after hearing about him for many years and to see how kind he was to a young singer who had just moved to town from West Virginia. So congratulations, Jim. Sorry you aren't here to see this in person, but I know that you would be honored by these people remembering you and your contribution to music and beyond.
Barbara Nisman is widely recognized as one of the world's finest concert pianists. Hale is one of the last great pianists in the grand romantic tradition of Liszt, Rachmaninoff, and Rubinstein. She has performed with leading orchestras on almost every continent. Her recordings of Prokofiev, Bartok, and Ginastera are considered definitive, and she has garnered lavish praise for masterful renditions of the works of Beethoven, Chopin, Liszt, Schumann, Brahms, and Rachmaninoff. She's also in demand as a writer, lecturer, guest artist, and clinician, both in the U.S. and abroad. A West Virginia resident since 1989, Nisman was born on December 31, 1944, in the West Oak Lane section of Philadelphia to Albert and Sophia Nisman. She fell in love with the sound of the piano when her older sister started playing. She begged for lessons, but soon discovered that she was definitely not a musical prodigy. "Don't waste your money," her first piano teacher told her mother. "Your daughter will never play the piano." Undaunted, Nisman persevered and proved to be a radiant late bloomer. When the first blossoms appeared at age 11, she knew what she would do for the rest of her life. Nearly seven decades later, she's still in love with the piano and the great music written for the instrument. Commuting to the Juilliard School in New York for lessons during high school, she was awarded a full scholarship to attend the University of Michigan's School of Music. She graduated with both a bachelor's and a master's degree in 1966 and won the school's Stanley Medal, honoring the highest achieving student. She completed a doctorate at Michigan 3 years later, and in 1981 received the university's Athena Medal for outstanding professional and humanitarian endeavors. Nisman's international career was launched by legendary conductor Eugene Ormandy, who, after hearing her perform as a doctoral student, arranged her debuts in all major European capitals. She subsequently made her American professional debut with the Philadelphia Orchestra, with Ormandy conducting. Since then, she has performed with the leading orchestras throughout Europe and America. She has worked with some of the major conductors of our time, including Ormandy, Ricardo Muti, Stanislav Skrovachevsky, and Leonard Slatkin. She was inducted into the inaugural class of Steinway Legends, chosen from more than a century of Steinway artists. From 1970 to 1982, she was based in Amsterdam in London. While in London, she initiated a TV series, Barbara and Friends, for BBC Television. Years later, collaborating with the Greenbrier Valley Theater, she adapted this program for use in public schools throughout West Virginia. One of the most significant facets of Nisman's career was her association with Argentinian composer Alberto Ginastera, who she met while attending the University of Michigan. The famed composer was so impressed by Nisman that he wrote and dedicated his last work to her. Recognized today as a leading authority on Ginastera, Nisman has premiered and recorded his complete works and recently completed a video masterclass devoted to the composer. Her immersion in his music has led to friendships and collaborations with other Ginastera fans, including rock keyboardist Keith Emerson and jazz pianist Chick Corea. Nisman is also renowned as a leading Prokofiev interpreter, making history in 1989 by being the first person to perform Prokofiev's complete piano sonatas in a series of recitals in New York and London. In the late 1970s, Nisman served as artist-in-residence for the John Deere Corporation, providing recitals, master classes, and a music lecture series to deer plant communities in the U.S. and abroad. This was the first time an international corporation had employed a classical artist to serve its worldwide community. In 1987, Nisman married the love of her life, the esteemed poet Daniel Haberman. The two met at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine in New York City when Nisman was performing a memorial concert for Ginastera. Haberman, the cathedral's first poet in residence, was founder of St. John the Divine's American Poets' Corner. In search of a home where a poet and a pianist could live together with the peace and quiet to work, they settled on a farm in Greenbrier County, West Virginia in 1989. Sadly, he passed away just 2 years later, but his spirit continues to inspire Nisman. From 2002 through 2011, Nisman was involved with the Robert James Fresino AIDS Foundation Benefit Concert Series, a concerted effort. These concerts have raised well over $2 million for AIDS service organizations worldwide. In 2007, she appeared on stage with Don Henley and Billy Joel, performing on the Walden Woods Steinway in a fundraiser for the Walden Woods Project at Jazz at Lincoln Center. In 2008, Nisman received the Governor's Distinguished Service to the Arts Award from the state of West Virginia. She was presented with the Governor's Lifetime Achievement in the Arts Award in 2020. In 2014, at Steinway Hall in New York City, Nisman launched her record label, Three Oranges Recordings. 3 years later, she established the Three Oranges Foundation with the mission of making classical music accessible and relevant and supporting her assorted educational projects. Last year, Nisman returned to Amsterdam to commemorate a concert series she helped to found 40 years earlier. She received a hero's welcome with an audience of 12,000 coming out for the show, an additional 1.2 million viewing via live television broadcast. At 78, Nisman continues to be an artist who is constantly growing and evolving. Her playing is as dynamic as ever, and her performances are all-consuming musical experiences for the audience.
To induct Barbara Nisman into the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame is internationally renowned drummer and percussionist, a multi-Grammy Award nominee, and a founding member of the Jazz Crusaders, who garnered numerous platinum and gold albums during its 30-year run. Please welcome Styx Hooper.
Well, first of all, I want to make sure that you can hear me. Okay, so I'm going to do something. Michael probably isn't going to like this, but I have been around the world many, many times, many, many places. But to see you people sit there and not getting up for an intermission, at least, I want to see you stand, just to be ready to take it up. Let's see that first. Before take a load off of you know what. Okay. I think 10 seconds is good enough. Anyway, first of all, it's been a hackneyed term in terms of saying it's an honor. Now, it's more than an honor. It's an honor for me to be here and to have known Barbara for many years. We had the same management, and to be able to develop our careers almost simultaneously in two different genres. And also, I want to just pay respect totally to the state of West Virginia and what Michael Lipton and all the people are doing to have a broader spectrum other than what's indigenous to this state, which of course, you know, is the bluegrass, the music that is more indicative, and to acknowledge the classical medium and to be able to relate to the fact that music is music. It's a matter of expression. It's an audio art that requires a certain amount of skill, dedication, creativity, and all of those things. And even Albert Einstein said, of course, creativity is excellence coming to life. So I just wanted just to do that first before we do anything. Any of the things that what Missy had said about me, just cast that out because that's irrelevant. But I want you to introduce you to one of the world's greatest pianists, greatest pianist, a wonderful person who has been blessed to have not only the ability to execute great things on the piano and to acknowledge some of the great composers. And we call it the classical medium, but actually it's Baroque music that has complete longevity. But we get into acronyms and things these days. We don't get into explaining things in the entire way it's supposed to be explained. So without further ado, I'd like to bring on Barbara Nisman.
Thank you.
thank you so much. This means so much to me, especially since I'm an adopted West Virginian. But it has been such a blessing for me to live in West Virginia, so I thank you very much. And I fell in love with the piano when I was a little girl, and I think I fell in love with Liszt's Hungarian Rhapsody when I heard Bugs Bunny play it. I've been practicing it ever since. And several years after that, I began my love affair with Franz Liszt. Now, Liszt was really, I think it's accurate for me to say this, he was the first pop star, because before this guy even played a note, he had women feigning, drooling, tearing at his clothes, and that's why I call him the Elvis Presley of the 19th century. But when he sat down at the keyboard, that's when the fireworks truly started. And he mesmerized audiences everywhere. He loved the piano. He knew the piano better than anybody else. And he spread so much joy with his concerts. So I would like to perform in his honor and in your honor my favorite piece since childhood, Liszt's Hungarian Rhapsody No. 2. Thank you. Thank you. Now let's welcome our newest inductee to perform for you. At the piano, Miss Barbara Nisman.
These are very early pieces of his. He wrote the Argentine Dances when he was only 19 years old. He was still a student at the conservatory. And the first dance is the Dance of the Gracious Maiden, a beautiful love song with a guitar accompaniment. And this is followed by the Dance of the Clever Cowboy. And I must say the pianist has to be kept clever because he gives us all sorts of tricks to do up and down the piano. But this music is so full of life and joy, and it's the perfect music for this very joyous evening.
Thank you.
The careers of Clarence Eugene Fuzzy Haskins and Calvin Simon, West Virginia's own funk brothers, transported them from the coal fields of southern West Virginia to the helm of the country's most storied, groundbreaking, and influential funk band, Parliament Funkadelic. Along with George Clinton, Grady Thomas, and Ray Davis, they co-founded the original Parliaments in 1956 and stayed on board the mothership for more than two decades as it morphed into the deep soul, sci-fi funk, and acid rock of Parliament Funkadelic. Calvin Simon was born in 1942 in the East Park area of Beckley, Raleigh County. Early on, his mother Alice moved to New Jersey to find work, leaving Calvin with his grandmother, Mamie Simon. At her encouragement, he began singing in the Church of the Living God. He attended Stratton High School, Raleigh County's first all-black high school, which was also attended by Bill Withers. As Mamie got on in years, Calvin joined his mother in Newark when he was 15. Clarence Fuzzy Haskins was born and raised in Elkhorn, McDowell County. His mother died when he was 7 months old, leaving his oldest sister to raise the family. They sang gospel songs at home, and she taught Fuzzy to sing harmony. He attended Elkhorn High School, where he played football and took up the trumpet and trombone before settling on tuba. Eventually, he picked up the guitar. Strange but true. While Calvin and Fuzzy grew up just 60 miles from one another and shared an interest in music, they first met in Plainfield, New Jersey, at George Clinton's barber shop, the Silk Palace. Before long, a quintet of barbers and patrons became the first incarnation of the Parliaments. They recorded a number of sides, including Poor Willie. In 1963, the five singers traveled to Detroit to audition for Motown Records, running out of gas directly in front of the studio. While they opted not to sign with Motown, the group eventually released its first single, I Just Want to Testify, on Detroit's Revolot label in 1967. Afterwards, a contract dispute with Revolot prohibited Clinton from using the Parliament's name. As a result, he renamed the band Funkadelic and then sidestepped the suit by dropping the S from Parliaments. While in Detroit, the group became part of the burgeoning 60s rock scene, sharing bills and hanging out with MC5, Vanilla Fudge, and the Stooges. Parliament's first LP, Osmium, was released in 1970. Stylistically, it was a wildly mixed bag, but the genie was out of the bottle. Gone were the stage suits and ties. Members were encouraged to create their own freeform costumes that accented the band's gritty funk. As the music expanded, the stage shows followed suit. The next trio of releases were instant classics: Up for the Downstroke, Chocolate City, and Mothership Connection, arguably the pinnacle and the first LP to be certified platinum. You got a real type of thing going down there now. There's a whole lot of rhythm going round. You got a real type of thing going down there now. There's a whole lot of rhythm going round. What a party, people, that's y'all. We want the bones, come on. Taking James Brown's deep grooves to the next outrageous level and coupling them with Dadaist theater, the band was as intense visually as it was musically. There was simply nothing else like it. But beneath the full-on party vibe was a deeper holistic message. We are all in this world together. Or as the title of another Funkadelic record stated, One Nation Under a Groove. Calvin and Fuzzy left the band in 1978 following the live P-Funk Earth Tour. Along with Grady Thomas, they released Connections and Disconnections under the name Funkadelic in 1981. Calvin, Fuzzy, and Grady rejoined the mothership a little more than a decade later as part of the P-Funk All-Stars. Fuzzy released his first solo album, A Whole Nother Thing, in 1976, which featured a number of key P-Funk members. 2 years later, he issued Radioactive. In the late 1990s, Calvin and Fuzzy briefly toured with Original P, which also included charter members Grady and Ray Davis. In the 1980s, both Calvin and Fuzzy left secular music for more than a decade. Fuzzy became an ordained minister, while Calvin, reassessing his career and lifestyle, turned exclusively to gospel. After battling cancer, Calvin was saved in 2002. He helped start the Sky Baptist Church in Beckley, where his brother-in-law, Reverend Bill Fruit, remains pastor. He was the first person to be baptized there. His 2004 release, Share the News, reached number 32 on the Billboard Gospel chart. All told, Parliament Funkadelic has amassed 15 gold records and 7 platinum records, and is the second most sample funk group, surpassed only by James Brown. In 1997, none other than Prince inducted Fuzzy, Calvin, and 15 other members of Parliament Funkadelic into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. In 2019, they were given Grammy Lifetime Achievement Awards. Calvin passed away in 2022, and Fuzzy passed earlier this year on March 17, 2023.
Is this not an insane night? Oh my. How many people remember Parliament George? Yeah. Oh my gosh. My co-host, Missy Raines, just said that the bass player you're going to see in a minute is her new spirit animal. And, I just got to say this, the count is in the house. Yeah. Our next, but just before we get there, our next presenter first heard the music of Parliament Funkadelic at an early age when they rehearsed in his grandmother's basement during layovers in his native Detroit. He is considered one of the group's primary and foremost historians, and he toured with the band in 1995. Give it up for Gabe Gonzalez.
What's up, y'all? Ready to give up the funk? Wow. It's an honor to be here, first of all. And I just have to say, that was an amazing performance by Barbara. I have to say that once again. Like, wow, she blew all of us away. But I'm here tonight to present on behalf of Mr. Calvin Simon and Clarence Fuzzy Haskins. But before we do that, I got some videos from my funky uncles. We're gonna show y'all. Y'all ready for this? From Mr. Grady Thomas, one of the original Parliament members, and as well as Mr. Bootsy Collins. Y'all ready for this? Check it out.
Hello, everybody. This is Shady Grady Thomas. Speaking about two wonderful friends of mine, Calvin, Eugene, Simon, Clarence, Haskins, Fuzzy Haskins, Eugene Fuzzy Haskins. I met Calvin Simon when we was going to elementary school. I seen this big, long, tall drink of water walking down the hallway. I asked him, hey, what's your name? He said, Calvin Simon. I just got here from West Virginia. I said, well, okay. Calvin and Fuzzy were some great guys. They was two of my buddies. Just the three of us. We could make it if we tried. Just the three of us. They were some beautiful guys, and I appreciate them. I love them. They love me. Now I know they're up there singing with my that my son and other people and Bill Withers, and they're having a good time, I know. So, anyway, I love y'all. Hey, fellas, keep it going. Okay, bye.
Bootsy Collins here, and I'd just like to say to the Haskins family that Fuzzy was such a blessing to so many people, especially myself when I first got with Parliament Funkadelic. You know, he made it real easy to be out on the road and have fun. You know, he was not only a great entertainer, a singer, a dancer, a writer, a producer. He was all of that, but then he had fun with it. He allowed you to have fun. And me and my brother Catfish love to be around when Fuzzy was around, because Fuzzy was, you know, he had another kind of humor, you know, and it was just so much fun and so much joy. And not only around us, everybody that he would get with, everybody that he was involved with, seemed to have fun around him and could communicate. So we are missing Fuzzy with all our hearts. And our love goes out to him for doing so much more than he even thought that he did. And we're just sharing our love and our prayers for the family right now in this difficult time. But I'd just like to say thank you, Fuzzy, for all you've done for me personally. Hallelujah. Glory to God on the one.
Well, there it was, y'all, from one of the funkiest men on the planet. Y'all know Bootsy Collins, James Brown, Parliament Funkadelic, and you're giving it up. I mean, there's much love here in West Virginia. I'm just honored to be here and, you know, to share a few experiences, knowing some of them. I got into this music probably, believe it or not, half a century ago, literally. I was 5 years old, and I had one of those little Mickey Mouse record players. Y'all remember the ones, you know, the little small fold-up plug-and-play. And I got sick of playing those Peter Pan records on there. And my uncle, he was a hippie, and he turned me on to a few records. I think one was Grand Funk Railroad. Another one was Sly and the Family Stone's Greatest Hits. And then one day he came in my room and said, "Here, put this on. They're from outer space." Now, I'm 5 years old, right? This is a true story. I didn't even prepare nothing. I'm gonna tell y'all whatever I'm gonna say from my heart, because that's how I do it. But he gave me this record and said, "It's from outer space." And when I put it on, he couldn't be further from the truth. I mean, the record just completely sucked me in. And I was 5 years old. And to this day, like I said, it changed my whole life and musically, because Parliament Funkadelic, people need to know, funk music is not what you think it is, per se. Funk is an attitude and a way of life, because Parliament Funkadelic, this band, we did country music, rock music, reggae music, soul music, and everything else under the sun. So that's one of the greatest things about being a part of this organization and alumni. And like I said, I'm honored to be here. And getting back to my story, so I played the album and I heard just one voice on there, and I thought it was David Ruffin from The Temptations, which a lot of people would hear Calvin singing and get it confused that it might be David Ruffin, but he had one of those type of voices. And the first time I heard a song called Qualify and Satisfy, if y'all don't know, look it up. I mean, it will give you the chills. It's electric blues and soul and rock. And they started that in 1968. So they're not only pioneering members, but they were groundbreaking. And Fuzzy also was a big influence on, I think, a lot of modern music. People like Prince was influenced by him. And, you know, several other people as far as a front man, because when you see Parliament Funkadelic, Fuzzy was somebody who stood out. I mean, he definitely, you seen him straddle the mic and do his thing. It was definitely entertaining to see. And, you know, like I said, they were on Casablanca Records, which, you know, had the biggest bands in the world, from Kiss to Donna Summer, Village People, et cetera, et cetera. So, again, I'm honored to be here tonight, and I want to present this award to the daughter and her friend Monica, Miss Joy McInnes, and Monica Bonamy, and Noel Scott, the son of Fuzzy Haskins. Y'all, give it up for him.
Some other folks.
I thank you all for being here. At 6'5" tall, my dad was always bigger than life to me as a little girl. However, when I was old enough to know what he did and the songs that they sang, I was so proud to tell everybody about who he was. I grew up in the 80s, so their big hits were during my tenure. And oh my gosh, when in every time something came on the radio, I would say, "That's my dad, that's my dad." And, you know, my friends would be like, "Oh my God, that's so cool." And, but I'm just so honored to be here to accept this award on his behalf. May you continue to rest in peace, Daddy. I miss you. And I love you. And I thank you, Michael Lipton, and the Western West Virginia Hall of Fame for this opportunity, the invitation, and the honor to be here. I thank you so much.
Praise the Lord, everyone. that was my father's greeting. Anybody who knew Fuzzy, know that's the way he would greet you. If you called him on the phone, that was his way of saying hello. It was always praise the Lord. And we do praise the Lord because we're still here, and we thank God for all that he's given us, for our parents. You know, Dad was just such a special person in more ways than one. You know, he was West Virginia from start to finish. You know, he never left that part of him, and that part of him never left. You know, he had this song on a album that he did called, the name of the record was called Radioactive. The name of the song was called Silent Day. There was a lyric in the song that said, "I don't know what I'm searching for, but I know I have to get me a good score. I don't know what the future might bring, but I know that this life makes me sing." So I thank God on tonight, and I thank my dad for all of his searching, and I thank God for his singing, you know, because it's brought all of us together to this place. we live in a time now, you know, we're experiencing the beauty of your wonderful state, but we live in a time now where we are, you know, you can't always count on, the children can't always count on posthumously honoring their parents. It's the other way around where I come from. You have a lot of parents that are honoring their children that have gone on. But I'm grateful on tonight for the gift. I'm grateful on tonight for the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame, for Mr. Michael Lipton. I'm grateful for him and for the presenter on tonight, my brother Gabe Gonzalez. You know, I thank God for him. We hadn't seen each other for quite a long time, but you know, the love and the camaraderie that we have between us has never left. We played in some bands together. Like he shared with you all, I think I have one of the greatest upbringings that a kid could ever have. You know, my uncles were different kinds of guys. You know, and that's all I ever saw them as was just uncles. You know, they were my dad's friends, so they were our uncles. And I thank God for all the experiences that we've had together, all the music that we've made and played together. I thank God for like Mr. Walls, Mr. Wilson Walls. My middle name is also Eugene, as well as my father's middle name is Eugene, as well as my brother's middle name was Eugene. So it's something about the Eugenes that's really great. But you know, this has just been overwhelming to me. You know, I'm here honoring Dad. You all are here honoring Dad, and we appreciate that. But I'll tell you, the greatest honor is really bestowed upon me to share a stage and grace a stage with musicians like I've played with on tonight, from start to finish, just to experience this in this room with you all, the love that you give from this state. I am so appreciative and glad to be here. So thank you, West Virginia. We appreciate you, and let's keep the funk alive.
All right, y'all, right here tonight in Charleston West, by God, Virginia, with a medley of some of the funkiest grooves of all time, paying tribute to Parliament Funkadelic, Count Funkula and the P-Funk Outlaws.
Universal lover, space people, universal.
3 young sisters and 2 young brothers. Seen it hard, I seen it kind of rough. But always with a smile, she would surely try to hide the fact she must that life was really tough. I can see my mother call. Father, Father, it's for the kids and everything I did. But please, don't you judge me too strong. Lord knows I did no wrong. Lord knows I did no wrong.
And the devil said, would you like to dance with me? We're doing the cosmic slop. Would you like to dance with me? We're doing the cosmic slop. Would you like to dance with me? We're doing a comedy slop.
Then if it were talking, call a Jezebel. But always with a smile, she would surely try to hide the past of us that life was really hell. Hey, I can hear my mother call. I can hear my mother call. Father, Father, it's for the kids and everything I did. Please don't you judge me too strong. Lord knows I did no wrong. Lord knows I did no wrong. Y'all in trouble now. I done came back to earth. Hold on, be strong, y'all. Everybody's bonging and don't know how. Check this out. Back by popular demand to rock the motherland. You even here. Can I say this now? Check this out. Good evening. Do not attempt to adjust your radio, there's nothing wrong. We have taken control as to bring you this special show. I'll give it back to you as soon as you're approving. Welcome to radio station WFUNK, y'all. We funk a deeper sphere of the mothership connection, home of the extraterrestrial brothers, dealers of funky music, P-Funk, Uncut Funk, The Bomb. We are the Outlaws, y'all. And the Outlaws, we see y'all funky. We see y'all funky.
Y'all look real good. Let's
do it. Say it.
Everybody funky and it's right on time.
Everybody funky and it's right on time.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody funky and it's right on time.
Right on time, baby.
Everybody funky and it's right on time.
Come on.
All right, hold on. Drop your socks and let the fungus grow among us. Yeah, y'all. Get Let's take them up. Get up for the downstroke. Everybody get up. Get up for the downstroke. Everybody get up.
Come on, y'all.
Get up for the downstroke. Everybody get up.
I see you.
Get up for the downstroke. Everybody get up.
Fall back.
Let me feel that groove. Let it cook, y'all. Oh, yeah. Everybody funkin' and it's right on time.
It's right on time.
Everybody funkin' and it's right on time.
You know, yeah.
Everybody funkin' and it's right on time.
I can't hear you say, yeah.
Everybody funkin' and it's right on time. Hold on, y'all. I got a little something coming from Noel and Gabe Gonzalez. Can y'all help me out? I think I feel some cookie jar up in here.
Uh-huh.
I don't know what to do with you when I get you.
Uh-huh.
Come on.
I'm gonna put you in my cookie jar.
Uh-huh.
Save it for a rainy day.
What'd he say?
I don't know what I'ma do with you when I get you. I'm gonna put you in my cookie jar.
Yeah,
but save it for a rainy day.
I don't know what I'ma do with you when I get you.
I'm gonna put you in my cookie jar.
Save me for a rainy day.
One more time.
I don't know what I'ma do with you when I get you.
I'm gonna put you in my cookie jar.
Let's ride, Ned. Uh-huh.
Save me for a rainy day.
Let's ride. Come on.
Ride, ride. La da 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 for the funker. Let it cook a little bit. Let it simmer. Make believe we baking, y'all. Let it simmer. Let the funk just simmer.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, y'all. Ain't that day? Ain't no joke.
Nope.
Let's sing. Ain't no joke. They call it the slow stroke. Ain't no joke.
Come on, let me see.
They call it the slow stroke. They call it the slow stroke, stroke, stroke. Ain't no joke.
I see you look good.
They call it the slow
Let's
stroke.
Let's
ride. Ride, ride. La, da, 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 for the funkers. Ride, ride. La, da, 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 for the funkers. All right, y'all. And it's right on time. Everybody funkin' and it's right on time.
Yeah.
Everybody funkin' and it's right on time. Keep it right there, y'all. Everybody funkin' and it's right on time. Keep it right there, don't go nowhere. Everybody funkin' and it's right on time. Everybody funkin' and it's right on time. Let me hear just the voices. Everybody stop. Everybody's funkin' and it's right on time.
Everybody's funkin' and it's right on time.
One, two, three, four.
Yeah!
Woo! Come on, y'all.
Good evening, y'all. This is Count Funkin' and the P-Funk Outlaws. Get ready to take you to the next level, y'all.
Woo!
Yeah, all your ladies out there, all your fellas out there, let's sing.
Let's go.
Outlaws, sing.
If you hear any noise, it's just me and the boys in bed. I got a hit in the bag. If you hear any noise, it's just me and the boys in bed.
All right, here we go right here. How are you doing? Oh, yeah. I just like to feel that groove, don't y'all?
Woo.
Audience, give me some clap.
Come
everybody.
On, y'all.
It's just me and the boys in bed.
somebody hit me back. If you hear any noise, it's just me and the boys. Hit me. You gotta hit me back.
All right, check this out. No, give me some. No. No's gonna give me something. No's gonna give me something.
And it's not, it's just me and the boys. Hit me.
Come on, y'all.
You got to hit me.
Represent No, come on.
If you have it, it's not, it's just me and the boys. Hit me.
Come on, No, keep going. Singing it.
I'm gonna ride when the mothership come. I'm gonna ride.
Yeah.
I'm gonna ride when the mothership come. I'm gonna ride.
Come on, pick me. Come on.
I'm gonna ride when the mothership come. I'm gonna ride. I'm gonna ride when the mothership comes. I'm gonna ride. Swing down, sweet chariot, stop and let me ride. Swing down, sweet chariot, stop and let me ride. Swing down, sweet chariot, stop and let me ride. Swing down, sweet chariot, stop and let me ride. Swing down, sweet chariot, stop and let me ride.
I wanna ride.
Swing down, sweet chariot, stop and let me ride.
Come on. Bring it down, Phil. Come on, Joe. Come on,
Joe. Oh, yeah.
Come on, Noah.
I want to ride.
Come on,
West Virginia. Y'all want to ride tonight?
Yeah.
I want to ride. Oh, yeah, yeah. And I'm going to ride. Come on, y'all sing with me.
Come on, y'all sing with
me. I want to ride when the mothership comes. I want to ride. I want to ride when the mothership comes. I want to ride.
Do you want to ride?
I want to ride when the mothership comes. I want to ride. I want to ride.
Ladies and gentlemen, Duke Shirelle.
I
want
to ride.
Come on, Shirelle. Come on, Duke.
How about that?
Thank you so much for joining us for tonight's ceremony, and congrats again to all of our nominees. Hasn't it been an amazing night? Thank you to everyone working to make tonight's show and broadcast possible, including the board of the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame, its director and founder, Michael Lipton. Yeah! His staff and the many volunteers and partners who help make this night special. And I will tell you that we have been taken such great care of, and they have been on top of everything. So we thank them from the bottom of our hearts.
I don't know when I've been a part of a show with this kind of diversity. This is insane, and it's just, man, how great is it? A lot of takeaways from a night like this when you see a classical pianist, a funk group, bluegrass. Oh, so great. Hey, we are going to invite many of our guests, inductees, presenters, and performers back for one more song to close us out. So hang on. Here to lead us is co-founder and longtime host of Mountain Stage and a member of the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame Class of 2020, Mr. Larry Gross. Okay. I can tell from the ripples in the curtain, things are happening back there. I'm not...
How about this amazing crew?
Yeah.
This amazing crew. Amazing.
That's right.
Yeah.
How about our amazing crew? I got to... Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say that the amazing crew working backstage, but there's also been a crew downstairs that's been feeding us for 2 days. And I want to send a big shout out to those folks, to Victoria and all the folks that have been, like, literally feeding this motley crew for 2 days. You can imagine what that's been like. There's been a lot of, what's so special about this event, I've been honored to be part of the award show a time or two before here, and it's just a great honor to come back. What I love about this show is the sense of family that exists with the board and with the folks that are working back there, the crew, and all the folks that come together to make this happen and to honor the music that comes out of this grand state of ours of West Virginia. Makes me very proud.
Yes. I just want to say again, most musicians I know are fans of musicians.
Yeah.
And no matter who was out here tonight, Buddy Griffin, Tim O'Brien, Barbara, P-Funk, they're all backstage cheering each other on. I just think that's pretty amazing and inspiring. All right, let me say this again. Here to lead us, this guy, man, I'm a fan of this guy. And I used to do his song, Junk Food Junkie, as a teenager. But he is the co-founder and longtime host of Mountain Stage and a member of the West Virginia Music Hall of Fame, Class of 2020, Larry Gross.
All right. As you see, we've assembled quite the cast of characters up here. And we're going to do one more song. This song was written by Fuzzy Haskins, and it was recorded by Parliament. And if you listen, you go on the internet, you can find them talking about the song, and then you'll hear the version that they did in the studio. And as they're talking about it, they're playing a version of it, and they're talking about how, well, let's do this kind of hillbilly style. And that's what they say on the thing. So we're going to start, everybody's going to have a piece of it. We're going to start out with the hillbilly style, and we'll end up with the funk style. Work our way from one place to the other. So here we go. This is called Automobile. We ready, everybody? Not ready. Okay. That means we're not ready. Whoa. We're getting there. We're getting there. We're getting there. Oh, okay, good. You get the glasses. Check it out. Tell us, Richie, when we're ready here. Ready? Okie doke. All that I want is a little kiss. All that I want is a teeny weeny hug. If you be nice to me, come on everybody.
Oh, I'll be good to you. We'll both ride home in my automobile.
Tim and Jen, sing it for us now. Charlie, play the harmonica, Charlie McCoy.
A little closer, my dear. Won't you sit just a little closer, my love?
Ooh. If you'll be nice to me,
well, I'll be good to you.
And we'll both ride home in my automobile.
Tim O'Brien on the mandolin. On the fiddle down there. Bring it down. Jim Gabor, let's keep the hillbilly thing going with that banjo. Here is now Count Funkula.
You don't have to be what I feel.
Austin on the guitar back there. Come on, Rob, on the saxophone. Come on, Duke Chappelle on that guitar. Come on, Duke. Come on now. Everybody sing the first verse. Come on.
All that I want is a little kid.
Come on, everybody.
All that I want is a little bitty hug. If you'll be nice to me, well, I'll be good to you.
Yeah.